Need a bag, bruh. Send it through quickly. I'm making hits, dog. Like I'm in the big leagues. Told him that I gotta go, dog. I'm riding a road, y'all. I think that I'm back in my bag now. So I need that go, y'all. Got hits when he throwing a fastball. Just too quick for it. Peeling off like the whip orange. Seen the effort, it's piss poor. I got too much.
Was that used to do the raping and shit like that. Eventually they became my good friends, and they used to tell me stories, man. That cause Lawton, you know, Lawton's like a project, so it ain't like these prisons now. Lawton, the bus gonna pull up in the middle of the, damn near in the middle of the compound. It's 100 people standing around the bus seeing who's getting off the bus.
Fella like Hard Rock to hook up with that's gonna look out for him, that's been jailing all his life and everything. But he'll just have to make it on his own. If he's not strong enough, he'll get cigarettes taken, made into a woman or anything else.
I mean, look at the type of environment that we in. We closed in to the food with some shit. You know, if you don't have no outside support, you pretty much fucked up. So, you know, a lot of times you're going to be rebellious against certain things. You know, a lot of, you know, you're going to resort to robbing. You're going to do a little bit of everything.
It was hot during the summer and cold during the winter. If you didn't have the proper clothes on, you'll freeze to death. Definitely no AC. It wouldn't have been a fan. I hope you dance.
Until you die. The guy was chased into the unit, and the guy chasing them stabbed him. You know, down there they had swords, not just blades, they got swords, street swords that go into the case. So the guy got stabbed with one of them, went straight through him.
Who wants to look back on this and wonder where those years have gone?
Flames from the burning prison shot into the sky over Lorton, Virginia early this morning. Inmates fled the smoke and flames to an open baseball field on the grounds. Shortly after daybreak, one prisoner stabbed another, and a group of 100 tried to rush the guards. During that and other confrontations, officers fired blasts of birdshot and tear gas.
prison. Donna. Right on, we said Donna too. I thought that's why you said something, baby. Put them on display now. Better do shit on display, y'all. Right on, put a big brother Nana, y'all. Put them on display now. All right. I'm a sick.
My parents was followers of the Black Panther Party while they were young. And after J. Edgar Hoover put out a shoot to kill order on Black Panthers, they kind of transitioned into the Rastafarian community, which was somewhat of a new organization that was coming up called the 12 Tribes of Israel. They was living in Jamaica at the time too. So as young people, you know, that organization was preaching of Black unity and Pan-Africanism. Under the followings of Marcus Garvey.
I acquired out a death sacrifice of over 300 years. I shall use for the salvation of the 400 million black people of the world. And the day when I forsake my people, may God Almighty say there shall be no more life for you. I unequivocally rejected the racist assumption of much white American Christianity, namely that God had created the black man inferior and that he had intended Negroes to be a servant class, hewers of wood and drawers of water. Well, I predicated my view of man on the doctrine of Imago Dei. All men, regardless of color, are created in the image of God. Now, from this premise follow the equality of all men and the brotherhood of all men. The biblical injunction of Acts 17:26 reminds us that he created of one blood all nations of men that dwell on the face of the earth. I was most interested in brotherhood within his own race. Because if Negroes are created in God's image and Negroes are black, then God must in some sense
so
be black.
We all followed under, as me and my brother was born, we followed under that Marcus Garvey belief, and the music we listened to was based on Marcus Garvey belief, with people like Vernon Spear and Peter Tosh and Bob Marley. It was based on
ballers, chase those crazy bumpers. God above, we're gonna chase those crazy.
Bob, it's based on Marcus Garvey and Haile Selassie.
It is good that you are here to record this picture of me in my palace garden at Addis Ababa. People who see this throughout the world will realize that even in the 20th century, with faith, courage, and a just cause, David will still beat Goliath.
So that's how we grew up, listening to that and being around that vibe and that environment, because the Rastafarian community was a strong community. You know what I'm saying? They had a strong belief. You know, when you went to the organizations or you went to the meetings, it was a nice vibe, man. It was the colors, the red, gold, and green, and black. It was the pictures of Haile Selassie, Marcus Garvey, and all the great leaders that you know around the world. You're gonna see the Nelson Mandelas, and these are people that we studied. You know, we never studied. We didn't know anything about any white Jesus or the songs that we grew up listening to was Burning Spear singing Christopher Columbus was a damn blasted liar. Right? And so we understood that as young ages. But when we came, my parents was immigrants, and back then in the immigration days, what they did was, while they were in Jamaica, when somebody gets pregnant, especially in a lot of other countries back in the days too, when somebody gets pregnant, what you do is take a trip to America, have your child in America, and then take them back. But the whole goal was to make your children American citizens, because America had more opportunities. So that's what happened to a lot of us. We just became American citizens that way, because your parents came up here, had you, take you back. And then eventually you end up coming back to go to junior high school or elementary school or whatever. But while when we went back down there, you know, we was part of the community. We was part of the Rastafarian community. We was part of some of the teachings of the Black Panther Party. We all fell under that belief. So, like I was saying, at one time, you know, my mother was kind of seen as a rebel also, you know, in America, not in the islands or not in Africa. But over here, she was seen somewhat of a rebel too. You know, they suspect her one time of being part of Muammar Gaddafi's security detail. So they used to keep her eye on her. At the same time, my father was a producer. And he had a big sound set in Jamaica, matter of fact, called Jalov Music, which was one of the biggest sound sets at the time.
Jalov Music?
Yeah. And they had a DJ called Brigadier Jerry. You know, all of them came up around the time of Yellow Man and all them. So that was a big movement at the time. And my father was the head of that. At the same time, he was doing production with Bob Marley and Peter Tosh and Jacob Miller. And all these dudes, all these legendary singers used to be in my house, you know, Freddie McGregor. My auntie was doing a backup singer for Bob Marley. So I learned how to ride a bicycle from Stephen Marley taught me how to ride a bicycle. We used to hang with the Marley kids, right, when we was young. So we all came up together. But at the same time, that part of uptown Kingston, which was kind of the nice part, the Rastafarian community kind of kept you grounded, because you could be in a nice part of a community and you could get bougie, right? Because where we was in uptown. You could get bougie for real, but that part kept you grounded, because we used to go to this wasn't even hoods. They used to call it the gully, right? I'm talking about where you was walking down into a dried out river with nothing but big rocks. And you walk down into there and go into neighborhoods that was built in these places. And built with nothing but stone and wood, and nobody has any shoes. They got one goat tied up. That's going to be dinner for the rest of the week. Everybody blazing smoke, music playing good, but people was happy. You know, but that kept us grounded because those are the places we used to hang at. We used to hang in the gully. The gully was worse than the hood. We in the gully. The hood dudes didn't even go to the gully. Right? You had the Spanglers, you had the shower posse and the shower and gully man and all these crews, right? They from downtown really. They was from the hood. Right? But that gully that used to be in like Papine and those areas, that was a whole different ball game. And you know, it was a lot of weed being grown, a lot of weed being sold, a lot of weed being shipped. So, you know, that was part of the culture, but the weed wasn't considered a drug, right? And you know, in Rastafarian community, weed is not a drug. Weed was never a drug. Weed was considered the healing of the nation. It was considered the healing of the nation.
Because I'm cutting everything up. My question was this. But that selling part of it, because you know, I've seen it all. I've seen the big leaves, the big trees. I mean, let me say this to you. We thought we was getting high in Merle. I smoked one of them leaves and motherfucker had kept in the windowsill, the dryer. Man, I thought my head was going to bust open, man. I mean, that's just a whole nother level. But I'm asking you, but that was survival when they sold it, right? That wasn't.
Yeah. It wasn't based on trying to floss or nothing like that. It was based on survival, right? And also it wasn't looked at as negative because it was no different from selling some pineapples. You know, it was no different from selling some coconuts. You know, it's a plant. It was just illegal. It just became illegal through politics, right? So everybody, so the weed was pumping, and you know, that's how we became part of that movement. You know, we was in weed houses at 7 or 8 years old.
Corrupted DC employees became delivery boys, say federal investigators, smuggling heroin, crack, and pot for a drug ring operating out of a Lorton cell.
You can smell marijuana in different places down Lorton. You can go purchase in different places.
Nearly 20 grand jury indictments portray a chemical candy store open at all hours to all comers. Authorities say Henry Little Man James, a killer convicted in a freeway shooting attack, acted as enforcer for the gang of three inmates and two employees.
Used the Lorton mailroom to introduce drugs into the prison. Bribed public officials.
The U.S. attorney says this should be a warning of swift and stiffer punishment.
The crime bill increases penalties for assaults that occur at Lorton. And it also contains a death penalty under certain circumstances.
You know, bagging up weed and pushing it out the door at 7 or 8 years old. You know what I'm saying? And counting money. My brother's over here counting the money, and I'm over here bagging up, working for the older dreads. And that was almost like normal for the young kids come up under the older dreads. That was just part of the routine. You work in the house. You bag up, you count the money, keep it moving. It was no big deal, actually.
For lice. DC jail is for adults, so I was taken to a cell block with around 18 cells separated exclusively for juveniles charged as adults. I was given a prison number that would stick with me for the rest of my life, 235116, meaning I was the 235,000, 116th prisoner to come through the DC jail system since 1875, the day another jail was opened on 19th and B Street Southeast. This one was built in 1976. On 19th and D Street Southeast. DC was averaging over 15,000 new arrests every year. In order for me to be prosecuted as an adult, the prosecutor had to file a motion requesting transfer of a child for criminal prosecution. I also had to meet a certain criteria. The initial act of prior acts of violence, murder, attempted murder, assault with intent to kill, multiple armed robberies, etc. As I got on a juvenile block, I learned that the vast majority of the kids here had armed robbery or murder charges. Some had double and triple murders. Some were caught up in turf battles. Some were hitmen and some were just defending themselves. But we were all facing long time behind bars. I was facing 30 years. Most of the kids that went through the juvenile block were considered the creme de la creme of gunmen and young ballers in the city. We all knew each other or knew of each other. We knew who killed who and sometimes why that person was killed. We knew some of the same girls and frequented some of the same spots, so we would stay up all night talking about how much money we're going to make if we get out, which girls we're going to fuck if we get out, which cars we're going to buy if we get out, and which guns was our favorites. With our closest friends, we would even plot to kill their witnesses if we get out. One of the kids on the block name was Chester. He's from the south side. He kept his bed made, cell clean, floor shiny, and his shoes wrapped up in plastic bags. His cell was impeccable. This was extremely strange for a teenager. I thought he may have grew up on a military base or had strict military parents. But he told me his father, cousins, and uncles had all served a lot of time, and he grew up watching and listening to them. He was 16 years old and already mentally prepared to do 30 years. He was demonstrating institutionalization before even reaching an institution. It was also a lot of young men from New York on a juvenile block. The fratricide had begun between New York and DC hustlers, and killings were occurring daily on both sides. Most of the ones on the juvenile block weren't juveniles, though. DC didn't know their real identity, so they were able to lie about their age, telling the authorities that they were juveniles. They were trying to get to Oak Hill or Seton Hall so they could escape, but ended up in DC jail being charged as an adult. Some of them were really in their mid and late 20s. They all had bodies. One of them was riding in his Jeep Cherokee Limited with the system blasting. The back seats were removed so the whole back of the truck could be loaded with subwoofers and amps. It had the bright yellow and blue New York tags on it. He pulled up at a stop sign and some guys yelled out to him, "Hey Slim, turn that Bama ass shit down." He laughed at him and turned it up some more.
"You in the danger zone. I figured you would. Now leave me alone."
The music was so loud that it rattled windows three blocks away. While he sat in the truck jamming to the hard bass from EPMD and rolling a blunt simultaneously, he felt a stinging sensation in his arm, but he kept rolling. Then he felt a shoulder muscle spasm. He kept rolling. Then he felt his jawbone come loose and thought someone had reached into the vehicle and punched him in the face. But when he looked up, it was a barrel of a 9mm aiming at his head and hot balls were spitting directly towards him. The music was so loud that he didn't hear a shot. On the outside, the gunshots were a part of the rhythm. Nobody heard a thing. By the time he slammed on the gas, launching the vehicle into an intersection at rush hour and slamming into the side of a metro bus, he had already been hit 6 times. He had a warrant for a body in Northeast and 2 attempted murders in Brooklyn. So as soon as the hospital discharged him, he was brought to DC jail. He was supposed to be kept in an infirmary for treatment, but because of liability issues, they had no holding cells for juveniles, so they brought him onto the juvenile block. He could barely walk and was still wearing bloody gauze patches all over his body and head. We changed his bloody sheets and bandages every day until he was able to walk on his own. For everyone, on our 18th birthday, we would be sent upstairs with the adults. I was just turning 17 years old.
How does it feel, man, to start with what is essentially a couple of video files, and then 6 months later you hear? How does it feel, man?
I mean, it's awesome. You know, it's just one step at a time, slow walking, and make it happen.
How was you able to get some of the administration here from Lorton? I got a great video of the warden. How was you able to pull that off?
Well, what's crazy was once everybody found out what I was doing, and they started reaching out to me like, "Man, look, I love what you're doing. I love that you're documenting. I love that somebody from here that was in Lorton actually documented as opposed to, you know, National Geographic or something."
No doubt. We talked about that before. Did you have prior encounters with this administration? Like, did they see you when you was doing your thing?
Man, look, when we was down in Lorton, they all knew us. They knew who we were.
We was menace. We was menace for real. We created record problems for the people down low, man.
I'm very, very, very proud of y'all, man. You introduced me to Sean Branch. A door opened for me. You always been great to me, man. I appreciate you. I love your skill set. You fresh as a motherfucker. Come here, man. You niggas think y'all getting fresh around here, man. I love when y'all put it together, man. Shout out to DC.
Know all this stuff. You know, you arrogant, young. So, when I actually started going down, went into Lorton, into Houston, and had to take some of these same tests that they gave you in high school, I passed all that stuff with flying colors. And then when I had to see a psychologist, and the psychologist asked me certain questions, they're seeing that for my age, I'm educated, I'm not an idiot, I know where my ass at, and I think to a certain extent, it kind of works against you to a certain extent in those type of environments, in front of psychologists and judges and stuff like that, because if I kind of showed my hand at a young age, which I didn't know any better. You know what I'm saying? I showed my hand. I showed that I'm not an idiot. I showed that I know school. I know education. I could read anything and understand and comprehend what I read. I could, but at the same time, they're looking at you like,
this is one side of you, but we read another side of you that we're not seeing right here. That means you must know how to manipulate something, because what I'm reading doesn't say nothing from what I'm seeing. It's almost like two different people.
So the joint is, you could climb over the fence, right? Because it ain't had a big 8-foot fence with the concertina wires on it. It was our minimum, actually, and minimum security down Lorton, man. That joint was super sweet. I was actually on work training at minimum too. Minimum had programs you'll never believe, dog. You know what I'm saying? Because like I told you, Lorton had 8 different prisons, right? So minimum even had programs to where I get on a work program and I go into all the other prisons and might do some plumbing or cut grass and stuff like that. Or they have programs where they take you onto the street and you clean the streets, or they have programs that you actually work a 9-to-5 in the streets and then come back to Lorton in the evening, right? So minimum was like, it's a minimum security. Everybody there going home in like 2 years. But they had a female prison right next door to minimum. That female prison didn't have a chow hall. They didn't have a rec yard, and they didn't have any schooling. So they literally used to walk all these women into the male prison to go to our chow hall. Now we separated. They kind of tell us to stand back. We ain't locked down though. You stand back probably like 10 feet right there. All these females come into the prison, because all they do is walk down the yard and come through the fence, right? Come into the prison, use out. That's how crazy that shit was, right? And then, before I get to the other part, the visits over there was in the gym. So, for the visit to come to get to the gym, they almost walk across the compound to get to the gym. But it's an open compound, so while the visit is walking across the compound to go to the gym, walking to go to the gym. And we like this, walking right past them to go into the chow hall. So a few times, a woman might come in, you know, she put on a baseball hat and come in and blend right with us and walk back to the dormitory. Walk back to the dudes, man. We come out, watch each other back, climb that fence, crawl through the yard, crawl through the grass. You got to lay for a second, though, because sometimes they had a Virginia State Troopers out there lurking. Man, we crawl through that joint. Go right up to the female prison, and they had a low ass fence too. Scale that month. Hey, look, like I say, because they came onto our compound so many times, it wasn't nothing to let them know that, hey, young, come up here tonight. Keep that back door open. And you get up there, right? So the joint was sweet. Only thing you really had to worry about for real, man, was it was a lot of lesbians up there. So the lesbians they get jealous. Yeah. They get jealous if you fucking this chick right here. She see y'all climbing over this fence and coming over here. She might rat you out. And then you had some correctional officers, some dudes that was hitting some of the females too. So you had to watch out for them. But outside of that, man, once you climb and go through that back door, man, be orgies up that motherfucker, Joe.
Hey, listen up, boy. They look so good. My goodness. Say what now? Huh?
You just walk through to this. I give you memories, you know. It's crazy because you used to walk down these walks, have on your hoodie and your neck wrapped up. You don't get hit. You gotta hit somebody else, you know. It's a lot of knife pushing on this side, buddy. It's all gravy though. Make it out of here alive, man. It's a beautiful thing. Make it out of these places in one piece, psychologically, spiritually, mentally, and physically. You want.